each step with your confidence, 'cause I am yours. I am.
Yeah. Father in heaven, we are here today because we believe that we serve an awesome God. We present to you, Lord, the men of this church, the men of this community, the men of this city of Miami, and even, Lord, the men that we have not reached yet for Christ. We present them to you too. Come into our hearts, come into our minds, come into our souls. We surrender our lives to you because we know the church needs this. Our wives need to see that we are surrendered. Our children need to see that we are surrendered. Our community need to see that we are surrendered to the Almighty God. Because we know that he who the Savior sets free is free indeed. So in the name of the Father, the name of the Son, in the name of the sweet Holy Spirit, we give you our lives as men, as Christian men, as godly men, as men anointed to do a great work. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Good morning, family, friends, and guests. As boys are growing up, they often hear the phrases, boys should not cry, man up, or be a man. Well, here's the problem. In a day where more than 50% of marriages end in divorce, many of these boys are left in the wake. Many boys aren't taught what it takes to be a Christian man. If we want to make the Me Too movement obsolete, if we want to stop children from being harmed, we need to teach them how to be men. That's what this weekend is all about. It's time to strip away the mask of hypocrisy and give the appearance of what people want us to be in and put the whole armor of God and be who he wants us to be. So please let us stand and repeat our affirmation of faith. Exodus 20 verses 8 to 11 and John 3 16. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shall thou labor and do all thy work. But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work, thou nor thy son, nor thy daughter, nor thy manservant, nor thy maidenservant, nor thy cattle, nor thy stranger that within thy gates. For in 6 days the Lord made the heaven and earth, the sea and all that is, and rested on the seventh day. Wherefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it. For God that he gave, that whosoever shall not perish, but have everlasting life.
Gracious Father, we come before you this wonderful Sabbath day, Father. This day you created for us to fellowship, Lord. A day you've created for us to lift you up. You brought us together, man and woman, Father, to worship you on this men's ministry day, Lord. This day is your day. This weekly vacation you've given us to not worry about work and school and bills and any of those things, Lord. You made this day because you love us. You made this day to protect us. You made this day to give us a sane mind, Father. And we pray that you will be uplifted today and you will get all the glory, and that this day will not be in vain, and that we will leave here with a special blessing. We ask you to bless every single person here. In the name of Jesus, we do pray. Amen.
Testing. You all may be seated. Good morning and welcome to Tabernacle Seventh-day Adventist Church. Me and my brother Jonathan are being tasked to give the welcome this morning. So with that being said, if you are here at Tabernacle for the very first time, I'm going to ask that you please stand right now. Amen. Amen. On behalf of our pastor, our first lady, and the members of Tabernacle, we'd like to personally welcome you to Tabernacle and thank you for visiting with us on this very special day. You may be seated.
Happy Sabbath, church. I'm going to try that one more time. I don't feel welcome. Happy Sabbath, church. I like that. Thank you. That felt good. Today is a very special Sabbath day, isn't it? Can we guess why? And no, it's not because I'm here. It's not because I'm here. Today is Men's Day, amen? Now give it up for these beautiful looking brothers over here to my right, these handsome men. Don't they look good in their black and white, their 007 look? Now there is nothing, maybe nothing, better than a man who is called to do God's work and a man that steps up to do the job. Amen. Now, recently, there was a survey done on what women want in a man. I hear some of my single ladies in the back saying, yes, yes. Now, the survey that they did had one common denominator. Majority of the women wanted a godly man. Now, a godly man, you ask, what is a godly man? What are the characteristics of a godly man? I'm going to go through 5 things that you should look for in a godly man. Now, you married women, you tell me if your husband meets these qualifications. If not, we're going to go to the back and we're going to pray. You single ladies, this is what you should look for, okay? Now, this is called mannerisms. You got that? You get it? Did you get it? Y'all didn't get that. Mannerisms. y'all sleeping. Y'all don't get it. Number one, a godly man stays. I don't mean just hangs around. I mean he's steady, consistent. He's not moved by outside circumstances. He's not easily moved by what people say. He's moved by what God says. Why? Because he's a person of faith.
Number two. Well, I'm super loud on this thing. Let me quiet down. I'm very energetic today. I guess you can tell. Number two, a godly man prays. I don't mean throw up wild requests hoping that the blessings rain down. No. A godly man knows how to stop and listen inside. He's given his heart to God, and God gives him instructions.
Number three, a godly man will praise. He's going to give honor where honor is due. He's going to thank God for all the good things that come to him because he knows it's not all about him. He's going to praise the women in his life because he knows with every strong man, beside a strong man, I'm not even going to finish that. You know the rest.
Number four, a godly man serves. He knows the greatest among you will be servants. He knows that his household is as a servant.
Number five, a godly man sows. He's an investor within his home. He's mindful of every seed of time, effort, and energy that he plants into his family because he knows that it is going to be multiplied into the next generation. So in conclusion, let me go through the five things again. The things you should look for in a godly man is a man that stays, that prays, that serves, and sows. Again, that stays, prays, praises, serves, and sows. That was five. Sister Merez, I'm gonna go through that again, since you're writing it down. A man that stays, you got that, I'm gonna wait for you to finish writing. A man that prays, a man that praises, that's three, right? A man that serves, and a man that sows. That's five, right? So at this time, I'm going to ask all the men, all the godly men, if you will stand right now, please.
We're just going to ask Chris Bart to step forward and give a prayer for our men today.
Father God, we just want to come before you right now because we know and understand that even though there was a first Adam and out of him came woman, there was a second Adam, your son Jesus Christ, and out of his side poured his blood. Thank you so much, God, that it is your blood that covers us, especially as men, to be the man that you've called us to be. A man that stays, one that is steadfast. I'm asking, God, that for those of us that can tend to be wishy-washy or flaky or just need to remove our double-mindedness, that you give us the ability and the gift of being steadfast. Lord, for men who might have difficulty communicating not just with their spouse or with others, but particularly with you, I'm asking that you may instill within us this desire to connect with you vertically, to connect with you spiritually, to pray to you, God, because we know that nothing can happen outside of prayer. So we ask that you may make us men of prayer. And praying is just not enough because in all things we should come before you in praise and supplication. So I'm asking, God, that we may be men that celebrate. Being too much of a stoic man is not what you've called us to be, God. You've called us to be a man who's joyful, a man who's thankful. Instill those qualities within us, Lord. And then even all of that, God, it's nothing if we do nothing with our prayer and our praises. So help us to be men of service. And lastly, God, help us to be men of legacy that we may sow seeds, our energy, our time, our resources into others, our families, the other men that are here, the other young boys that are here, the youth that are here. God, help us to be men of legacy because you are a God of legacy, and you had a son who is a son of legacy. We thank you so much, God. And so we ask that you may put a special covering over the men here this morning. In the precious name of Jesus, we do pray. Amen.
At this time, we're going to have our men's praise team sing our welcome song, and we're going to welcome each other the Tabernacle way.
Amen.
Come on, let's greet each other. Say hello. Happy Sabbath. How's your week been? Let's say hello to somebody that we've never seen before or that we don't normally speak to. Amen. Welcome.
Welcome, my brother. Welcome, my sister. Welcome to the house of the Lord. Oh, welcome, my brother. Welcome, my sister.
Happy Sabbath, church. Ooh, Chris was too loud, and I'm not loud enough. We'll try this again. Happy Sabbath. Okay, so, yep. So today we're celebrating our men of honor and what they mean to us. Men of honor are husbands, fathers, brothers, and uncles. They're teachers, mentors, and leaders who have a positive influence in the community. We at Tabernacle are blessed by many men who fit this description. And today we take time to highlight how the men of Tabernacle have impacted our lives. They are God-fearing and dedicate their lives to his service, reaching others for Christ and proclaim their faith by words and actions. They love their families, their wives, their children, parents, and, parents, and the parents return that love and respect, not because it's demanded, but because it is earned. They are confident and yet humble. They set out by faith and are driven to accomplish major goals, yet they are not afraid to admit when they need to stop and ask for directions.
Today we'd like to honor five men. Even though our congregation is full of men of honor, today we want to highlight the accomplishments of five men that are near and dear to us. The first, Brother Baldwin English. Can your, we ask the spouses to bring the wives to bring the husbands up to be honored. Brother English is a longtime Tabernacle Church elder. He's the current Pathfinder director. he served as the Southeastern Conference District 5 Pathfinder Coordinator. He sat for a long time on the Miami Union Academy School Board. He served as the lower division primary class teacher. He was a former AY Tabernacle AY ministry leader. He is a chef by trade, the husband of one wife, father of two, grandfather of four, Baldwin English. You can stay. Please stay. Brother Earl Gale. Known for his cool, calm, and gentle demeanor, skilled tradesman and gifted artisan, served as church building maintenance, serves on the development committee, and is a member of the hospitality and catering department. He is a husband of one wife, father of seven, grandfather of 10. Brother Cosmos James. From the beautiful, exquisite island of Aruba, bass singer with the Tabernacle's legendary Evangeliers, Pathfinder Master Guide, one of Tabernacle's first MV leaders, along with Sister O'Garrow, has served as Sabbath school teacher and superintendent, faithful and dutiful member of the Adventist Community Services Distribution, serves as security for Periality, husband of one wife, father of three, grandfather of seven. Kenneth Ned. Okay. Well, Elder Ned he's busy doing what he's always doing. He's busy. So he's not here with us, and he's here, but he's not here in the congregation. He's from the island of Grenada. He's an entrepreneur, longtime Tabernacle elder, enthusiastic Sabbath greeter, served as co-head of the Tabernacle Benefit Society, a board member of the Albert C. Pierre Community Services, former Tabernacle Communications Ministry leader, also a talented chef, husband of one wife, and a father of three grown children. And also... Okay. And finally, Elder Ronald Thomas. Okay. Elder Thomas was a member of Tabernacle's legendary Evangeliers, a longtime Tabernacle Church elder. Here's the part that I remember: early teen Sabbath school teacher and youth mentor. Co-head of the Tabernacle Benefit Society and headed the Gleaning Fund, a faithful Adventist community service volunteer. For 50 years, he ran a car repair and maintenance business specializing in Mercedes and Rolls-Royce models. He's a husband of one wife, father of two, grandfather of two, with many, many adopted children that he has mentored, myself included.
I think we ought to give these honorees a hearty amen. Do they look good? Wow. This is what our church is all about. If you don't have strong men, you have a real problem in your church, in your family, and in your community. So we give God honor and praise for what he has blessed Tabernacle with, these wonderful, strong men and their wives and their families. Amen? God bless you.
All right, good afternoon, good morning. This next person that we're going to honor is not a man. However, we feel that this person has done so much for the church that they deserve to be recognized for the hard work that they've put in, not only for God, but also to build our church. Now, this person goes about their business quietly, not seeking fame or attention. However, we're going to change that today. So what happened was, a couple of months ago, we came together, the AY committee, men's committee, et cetera, and we came up with the idea of giving an official name to our youth chapel. How many of us know we have the youth chapel upstairs? And we've been using it pretty much regularly over the last 2-3 years. So we felt that the only name that should go on that wall, that should bear that recognition, is the name of a young lady named Joanne Labossiere. To give you some backstory, when we discussed this in a church board meeting, many people were like, "Have you spoken to Joanne about it?" And the idea was for it to be a surprise, so that she could be as embarrassed as she is right now. All right, because we know that Joanne is one of the most humble human beings on the face of this earth, and she never would have agreed to this. So, to get her approval without her knowing, I actually called her. And I had a conversation with her about recognizing people and giving them their flowers while they're still alive. And she referenced somebody, and I said, yeah, we can recognize that person. And so I asked her, what if that person gets embarrassed? She said, well, sometimes people got to be embarrassed, all right? She said, they'll get over it. But you got to do what you got to do to bring that recognition. So I was like, perfect, thank you. And as a result, we move forward with it. We actually have two items. I'm going to need some help unfurling the banner, because it's a large banner that's going to go on the outside of the chapel, and hopefully it'll be there for all eternity. All right. I think it's upside down, yeah. Again, the official name is going to be the Joanne Labossiere Youth Chapel. And there's also a placard that will go on the wall in the chapel, and I'll let her sister read it for her.
This youth chapel is hereby named in recognition and appreciation of Joanne Labossiere, a great woman who has dedicated her life to positively impacting the lives of young men and women.
Amen. And we actually have some of the young men, especially, that she helped bring to God through Vacation Bible School, through Tab Kids for Christ, through the Wednesday night meeting, through all types of activities. So, Joanne, we appreciate you, we love you, and God bless you. Would you like to say anything? See, she doesn't even want to say anything.
Thank you.
right, it's children's story time. All our young men and women, come on down for your story. Joshua, make sure the computer sound is on. Good morning, little ladies and little gentlemen. All right, today we're going to be learning about a man in the Bible named Ezekiel. All right, the story is going to be up here, and when it's over, we're going to talk about it a little. All right, so make sure you pay close attention to the story of Ezekiel. Turn the volume up on the computer. Pause it in the meantime. Lower right corner of the computer screen, you'll see a sound card icon. Click it. There we go.
Ezekiel, God warned his people. Today's verse is Ezekiel 39:28. Then my people will know that I am the Lord their God, because I sent them into captivity among the nations. But then I brought them back to their own land, leaving no one behind.
Ezekiel prophesied from around 593 BC until 571 BC, about 22 years. That's the same time as Jeremiah.
Ezekiel was younger than Jeremiah and was in the very first group of Jews carried off to Babylon by Nebuchadnezzar, which included Judah's 18-year-old king, Jehoiakim. Jerusalem still hadn't been destroyed, so God used Ezekiel to warn the Jews in Babylon that bad things were about to happen back home. How God told him to warn them is very interesting.
Oh, so did he sing his warnings while riding a unicorn?
No, he performed some of his warnings in the streets, like little shows. For example, here's one thing God had him do. Rather than just yelling out, "The Babylonians are going to destroy Jerusalem," God told Ezekiel to take a brick and scratch a picture of Jerusalem onto it. He had him put it in the street and pile up dirt against it like the ramps armies build to attack a city. Then make tiny camps and battering rams around it and put an iron griddle next to it. Then Ezekiel was supposed to tie himself up in cords and lie next to the little model brick city every day for 390 days.
390 days? Staring at a brick?
We don't know how many hours a day he had to lie there, but yes, 390 days staring at a brick.
Let's review today's verse. Ezekiel 39:28. Then my people will know that I am the Lord their God, because I sent them into captivity among the nations. But then I brought them back to their own land,
pause it right there,
leaving no one behind.
Pause it. All right, so what were some of the things that we could take from that story of Ezekiel?
One thing that we can take from Ezekiel is that if we warn people about things that might bad happen, even if they are not listening, you still have to teach them how they're supposed to act. Like, for somehow in the story, Ezekiel stayed at the break for so many long days trying to warn the people that Jerusalem was going to get destroyed. So even if they are still even if they got the warning, people teach them how they're supposed to react, like men here.
Amen. All right. That was a long soliloquy. Good job, man. All right. Anybody else want to tell us what they could learn from that particular story, from that story? All right. Well, I discussed it with my son on the way here, and one of the things we discussed was the fact that Ezekiel had to do something that was very uncomfortable. All right. He had to do something that went outside of what he would probably do in that situation. And that teaches us that sometimes doing God's work can be uncomfortable for us, because we're going to be looked at as not being cool. And then sometimes it can be inconvenient. Inconvenient means you have to do it at a time when you really don't want to do it. All right. So just know that if God asks you to do something, and how does God ask us to do something? All right, he can send us messages through our parents. The things that our parents tell us when it's right and good, all right, those are ways for God to speak to us. And also, God speaks to us once we learn more about him and learns what he wants from us. All right, so in that story, he had to lay down for all those days trying to warn people. And in the end, a lot of people probably still didn't listen to him. But you should never allow that to stop you from doing the right thing. All right, you do it. If they don't listen, that's on them. It's not on you. All right, so thank you very much. We're going to pray to close, and we're going to go back to our seats and fan ourselves. All right, so who would like to pray for us to close? Close your eyes and bow your heads.
Heavenly Father, thank you for making us up. Please wake up. Amen.
Amen. I think that's the first time she ever prayed. Give it up for the girl. Give it up for her. Woo! We got to encourage our babies. All right. Walk back to your seats. All right. Walk. You can do it. Okay, there we go. Now you got to flip it.
Open up your hand to number 350, blessed be the tie that binds. Please stand.
Bless me the time. Sin crippled, sin crippled. fly to that above. Before our Father's throne, we pour our heart and prayers. Our ears, our homes, our needs, our own, our comforts and our cares. We share each other's
favor with God and man.
Amen. Amen. Please be seated. Please be seated. God is good and all the time. I've had a long week. I know every time I come here, I always complain I have a long week, don't I? But guess what? I'm here today and I'm going to lift God's name on high. Anybody came to lift God's name on high today? Anybody come and lift God's name on high today?
Amen.
This song, this first song we're going to sing, we're going to warm up a little bit. Say, Lord, I lift your name on high. Very simple song. I think we all know it. Okay, everybody together. Lord, I lift.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises.
I'm so glad
you're in my life.
I'm
so glad you came to save.
Let's sing that one more time. Say, Lord, I lift.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises.
I'm so glad.
I'm so glad you're in my life. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high.
Sound good. Sing, Lord, I lift your name on high. One more time. Lord, I lift.
Lord, I lift your name on high.
Say, Lord, I love.
Lord, I love to sing your praises.
I'm so glad.
I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us.
Say, Lord, I lift.
Lord, I lift your name on high.
Lord, I love.
Lord, I love to sing your praises.
I'm so glad.
I'm so glad you're in my life.
I'm so glad.
I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way from the earth to the cross. My debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high.
You came from heaven to earth.
You came from heaven to earth to show the way from the earth to the cross. My pledge of faith from the cross to the bay, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high.
Lord, I lift your name.
Lord, I lift your name on high.
Lord, I lift.
Lord, I lift your name on high.
Last time, Lord, I lift.
Lord, I lift your name on high.
Amen, 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 amen. As you can see, we have a men's praise team today. We haven't seen that in a while, huh? It's for me personally, it's a struggle to find songs to fit us, but I think God's gonna work today. He's gonna work and praise his name. I have a quick little testimony I wanna give. God saved my life a few weeks ago. For those who didn't know, I got in a car accident. I'm sitting at a red light, minding my business, and I hear an accident on the other side. When I look up to see what's going on, I see a Chevy Suburban heading straight for me. And it hits me. And it pushes me out the way and hits a car behind me. So that's three cars plus the fourth car in that car accident. But I'm here to tell you that how great God is. You know why? Because y'all hear that? Y'all hear that? What y'all hear? What y'all hear? I got breath in my lungs. I can walk. I have a tight back, but God is still good. God is still great. And this song says, how great is our God? The splendor of a king.
The splendor of a king.
Let me hear you sing. Clothed in majesty.
Clothed in majesty.
Let all the earth rejoice.
Let all the earth rejoice.
He wraps himself in light.
He wraps himself.
Darkness tries to hide.
Darkness tries to hide.
And trembles
at his voice. Trembles at his voice.
Sing how great.
How great.
Is our God.
Is our God. Sing with me how great.
Is our God.
Is our God. Oh, see how great.
How great.
How great.
Let's sing that second verse. Let's sing that second verse. From age to age he stands.
Age to age we stand.
And time is in his hands.
And time is in his
beginning
hands.
And the end.
Beginning and the end. Beginning and the end.
The Godhead.
The Godhead three in one. Father, Spirit, Son,
the lion.
The lion and the lamb. The lion and the lamb.
Everybody sing how great.
How great is our God. Sing with me how great is our God. Oh, see how great.
How great
is our God.
Let's say your name.
Above all names,
you are worthy to be praised.
You are worthy.
sing, how great is our God.
How great is our God. Sing with me, how great
is our God.
Is our God.
And oh, we'll see how great.
Oh, see how great.
How great. Say, the Lord is my shepherd.
The Lord is my shepherd.
He goes before me.
He goes before me.
Defender behind me.
Defender behind me.
I won't fear.
I won't fear.
Let's sing hallelujah.
Hallelujah, I am not alone.
Say he's my comfort.
He's my comfort. Always holds me close.
Let's sing it one more time. Say hallelujah.
Hallelujah. I am not alone.
Say he's my comfort.
He's my comfort. Always holds me close.
Okay, let's say he always guides me.
He always guides me
through the mountains and the valleys.
Through mountains and valleys.
Is his joy refreshing? Yeah.
His joy is refreshing.
Restores my soul.
Restores my soul.
Everybody say mercy and goodness.
Mercy and goodness. Gives me assurance
that I'll see his glory.
I'll see his glory.
Say
face
to face.
Face to face.
Say hallelujah.
Hallelujah. I am not alone.
Part is serious. You know it?
Your spirit lives within me, so I will walk in your peace. Your spirit lives within me, my victory. Your spirit lives within me, so I will walk in your
spirit.
Your spirit lives within
my victory.
My victory.
My victory.
Say your spirit.
Your spirit lives within me.
So I
will walk in
your spirit.
Your spirit lives within me.
My victory.
My victory.
My victory.
My victory.
Say your spirit.
Your spirit lives within me.
So I
will walk in your peace.
Your spirit lives within me.
My victory.
My victory.
My victory.
My victory.
Say your spirit, real soft.
Say your spirit lives within me. So I will walk in your peace. Your spirit lives within me. My victory, your spirit lives within me.
Aren't you blessed this morning, church family?
Amen.
This song to me is a very personal song. A very powerful song for me. Because it reminds me, and hopefully reminds everyone else, that God walks with you every day. That His Spirit lives within you. Last night, we had a very powerful service, the men. Make this really quick. And we talked about the different masks that we wear as men. The mask of shame that seeks to keep us from God when we fall. The mask of deception where we walk around with an image that we portray to people of who we are not. The mask of manipulation where we tend to not take responsibility for our actions. We want to blame somebody else. And finally, we talked about the mask of anger and how anger sometimes consumes us so much that we act out in ways that God has not ordained us to act out. But you know what I realized too? That's not just men. It's every single human being on this planet. We wear these masks day in and day out. And that's why I thank God that His Spirit lives within me. Not only does His Spirit live within me, I have the victory. We have the victory this morning. And we should all be thankful to be in the house of God. On my way to work here, I heard a horrible news in Indonesia. They had an earthquake and a tsunami. And the preliminary report so far this morning, over 300 people are dead. And we don't know these people had a chance to say, Lord, forgive me. We don't even know they had a chance to know a personal Savior in Jesus. But God has given us this opportunity this morning in this house at this time to come before His throne and say, Father, thank you. Father, forgive me. Father, renew me. Father, give me the victory over the iniquities in my life. So if you want to come up this morning and pray to God and ask, Father, I need you. Father, save me. Father, give me the victory. I ask you to come up at this time. And if not, you can just kneel at your seats. Lives within me, so I will walk in your peace. Your Spirit lives within me, my victory, your Spirit lives within me. So I will walk in your peace. Your Spirit lives within me, my victory. Your Spirit lives within me, so I will walk in your peace. Your Spirit lives within me, my victory, my victory. Dear Father, we come humbly bowed before you this morning. It is not because we are worthy, Lord, but it is because of your grace, Lord. Your endless, ceasing grace, Lord. That continues to watch over us and propel us each day, Lord. And Lord, we come this morning asking for forgiveness of our sins, Lord. Humbly bowing, saying that, Lord, we need you to give us victory over the masks that we wear day in and day out, Father. And Lord, we thank you for the blood of Jesus Christ who died on Calvary to give us this opportunity to come boldly before your throne, each and every one of us. So Lord, this morning I'm asking for healing. I'm asking for restoration, Lord. I'm asking for peace, Father God, not just in our lives, Lord, but in our families' lives, Lord, in this country that we live in, Lord, where it seems that everything is going. We pray for this world that is crying out, Lord, natural disaster after natural disaster, letting us know that your own coming is near. Lord, we pray for the individuals this morning in Indonesia, the families that are mourning, Lord, the loss of their loved ones. Lord, be with them at this time. Be with that country, Lord. Speak your word, Lord. Send your Holy Spirit to guide, Lord, and to comfort these individuals, Lord. And also this morning, we come before you here, Lord, saying thank you for this powerful day you have given, Lord, where the men of Tabernacle are standing and saying that we want to be men of God, Father God. And we are seeking your face, Lord, to strengthen and to uphold us so that we can be Christian men, not only in the church, but at home and in society at large, Father God. Bless this event. Bless the speaker who will be speaking this morning, Lord. We pray for those who are not able to be with us this morning. We pray for those who are watching online, Lord. We pray for those who are ill, Lord, and who need healing from you, Father God. Lord, we don't want to linger, but we want to say thank you, Lord, once again, for being our faithful Savior and friend, Lord. Renew within us, Lord, your strength as we continue to go throughout this day. In Jesus' name, let us all say, amen.
Your spirit lives within me, so I will walk in your peace. Your spirit lives within me, my victory. Your spirit lives within me, so I will walk in your peace.
Happy Men's Ministry Sabbath, amen. Ladies, if our men look good today, let me hear you say, mm-hmm. Look at this, we got Elder Walker looking clean over there. We got Pastor Taylor in his bow tie looking mean over there. We got even Elder Divine, fresh baby in hand, fresh on the scene over there. Tabernacle, if you are happy that our men are unified this morning, let me hear you say amen. You see, because you know that the devil has his tactics. And when it comes to dividing our families and our churches, this is the way the devil looks at it. If he can get the man, then he gets two for one. You see, he tries to trap the woman, but he tries to kill the man. You see, if he destroys the man, then he knows the woman will be crippled and expected to raise our young men without a male presence. You see, there's a major void when men are not present in the home and in the church. And I'm not speaking about voids in sports and strength. I'm speaking about the void of teaching our young men how to pray, how to treat women with respect, how to love, how to even cry, how to be humble. And then when all those lessons are learned, our older men teach our younger men how to be leaders, amen? How to be men of honor, men of stability, men of conduct, men of deportment, men of order, men of character, men of fearlessness, men of ministry, men about the kingdom of God. As these young men right here position themselves down the aisle, we have four men. Say amen for these four men right here. They're going to position themselves down the aisle. Go ahead and grab that red bucket, men, and position yourselves down the aisle. We are asking for a special offering today. This is separate from our tithes and regular offering. I'll get to that in a minute. These monies are going to go towards continuing to build our men's ministry. Amen. And that will grow and develop our boys to become men of God. So I ask that you please right now look for a special offering and place it inside of these red buckets. And we will lead by example, right men? Right men? If you have something in your pocket, if you have something in your purse, and if you're watching online, you can do this online as well.
at tabsda.org. We got a beautiful website there for you to give. This is a special offering right now for our men's ministry because led by our fearless leader, Elder Julius, let's give him a howdy amen, a round of applause and an amen for the job that he's doing. We will be leaders in our community. Now, as Sister Ned gets up here to help commission these deaconesses for our general tithes and free will offering, I want you to look in your bulletin, church. Look in your bulletin. And we see that our graph, based on last week, Elder Walker came up here, we had 37% left to go, but this week we only have 30. That's only a 7% increase from last week to this week from our goal. Is that good, church? And this is the last week, right, church? So it's time that we make sure that we put God first. Let me give you a quote. Let me give you a quote that I got to share with you. This really hit me this week. It said, take care of yourself, because when you die, your job will be posted online before your funeral. Let me make it even more relevant to you. When you get your money, take care of your God first, because your debt collectors are coming after your family members for their money immediately after your funeral. Does anybody in here have debt collectors that love them and say, how you doing, when they call you? It's time to put our God, what? First. It's time to make sure that when we do our budget, that he is on the top of that budget, amen? That is the secret. And when we give to God, he has said he will open up, what? The storehouses and pour us out a blessing that you won't even have room to receive. Do I have any witnesses that can wave their hands and say, God has been good to me? Even when I don't have much, God still provides. Amen? Sister Ned.
The deaconesses this morning to collect the morning's tithe and offering.
Let us bow our heads for prayer. Father God, we thank you today. We thank you today for your many blessings. We thank you, Lord, for how much you've done for us, Lord. But we know, Lord, that you ask for us to do our part too. And that's not to give selfishly, Lord, but to give willingly. Not to give because someone asked us for it, Lord, but to give because we know that you've given to us first. And if we are struggling, Lord, with the give, if we are struggling, Lord, because we got bills to pay, help us to remember, Lord, that we have nothing to lose when we give to you, because you will show up and show out for us in ways that we could have never even imagined. So bless our giving. Bless those that don't have to give. And please bless this special offering in the red buckets today for our men's ministry. Let Tabernacle say, amen.
Blessings and glory
and honor
and honor.
blessings and glory
and honor
and honor.
Belong to you. Blessings and glory,
blessings and glory,
and honor,
they all belong to you.
Last time,
blessings and glory,
and honor,
they all belong to you.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus, for blessing me.
With great, thank you, great pleasure to stand here before you to introduce our guest speaker. Amen. I've been knowing him actually for 5 years, and the way I got to know him was a delicate time in my life. I actually went to New York for my grandmother's funeral, and she passed away at age of 99, couple of months before she turned 100 from stomach cancer. You believe it? So unbeknownst to our guest speaker, went to visit our local church, come to find out he's the one that God has chosen to render service to my heart. Low days, low years. Family members are dropping left and right, and death is never one to be received well. So I thank him for those words that God has used him to be able to change my life. Pastor Jonathan grew up in the Mid-Hudson Seventh-day Adventist Church in Poughkeepsie, New York. He has a bachelor's degree in religious studies from Temple University in Philadelphia and a master's degree in history education from Boston College. He has served in various capacities at the North Philadelphia Shekinah Church in Philly and the Temple Salem in Brockton Temple in the Boston area. He has also served as a youth pastor in Maranatha Seventh-day Adventist Church in Queens, New York. He currently teaches world history in the New York City public school system and serves as a vice president for the Northeastern Conference Franco-Haitian Youth Federation. He was recently married to the former Miriam Bazar, and his highest pleasure is to introduce young people to Christ. Now, his wife was not able to travel with him, but Elder, please let her know from Tabernacle family that we send our warmest regards. Now, before you hear the voice of our dear guest speaker, Pastor Jonathan Coicou, you would hear Tabernacle's Bearers of the Flame men's choir. So pray for us, because God is good.
Higher ground, Lord, lift me up and let you stand. My faith on
just press that on down. Can we say amen again? We could do better than that, church. Can we say amen? It's beautiful to see so many of these brothers in Christ, these men singing for the Lord, serving the Lord. It's beautiful. It's been a beautiful day, a beautiful Sabbath. I'm truly blessed to be here worshiping with you guys down here in Miami. Yesterday when I left New York, it was like 59, 60 degrees. I had a little hoodie on and there's a little cool, you know, and when I got out the airport in Fort Lauderdale, I mean, the heat smacked me. They probably looked at me and said, we got us when he goes to New York. Look at him. He got a sweater on and a hoodie on. He doesn't know it's hot and humid down here. But I'm glad to be here. I thank God for his traveling mercies. I thank God for the Tabernacle SDA Church and the leadership of your pastor, Pastor Tony Taylor. Since the moment I stepped in, he's been great, welcoming me in and been so warm with me and all the men. And I got to give a special thank you to your dear men's ministry leader, Brother Eldridge Dumas. Stand up again, brother. This brother right here, I don't think you guys understand what he's been doing behind the scenes. Brother Eldridge, I mean, he's been in contact with me for a long time. And we kept contact, and he made this thing happen after God. And I'm grateful for the invitation, Brother Eldridge, and your family. They've welcomed me and took me in. They've been great, and I thank God for you, and I pray that God will bless you. When you take care of God's business, he handles your business. So I'm not worried about you or your family. God will take care of your family, Brother Eldridge. Thank you so much. I see a good family member of mine. I would like to nod. I see my cousin in God, mother. She's here. I see her in the corner of her dear husband. I was just with them out of the country earlier this month, and they just tied the knot, and it's great to see them. It's always good to come and find family out of state or wherever you're going. You know, it's important to do what we're doing, to have this men's ministry. We need everyone's ministry. If you go to most churches, the average church is probably now about 60 to 70% women a lot of times. And so a lot of brothers don't seem to be in church. Like I said, brothers don't like asking for directions. Brothers don't like dealing with their feelings. They don't like dealing with their emotions. They always say, you got to man up and be a man, they say. But a real man, we've been sort of been taught the wrong way to be a man. We haven't looked at Christ's model of what a real man is. And so we come here and we worship and we fellowship and we support each other. That's important for us as men. You know, I'm a teacher. I teach in a public school system in New York City. I teach at a high school in Brooklyn. And there was a woman that came in with a company last year at my school. And she worked for a company called ESI. And ESI, what it does is it goes to different urban areas and large school districts all throughout the United States to see how they can improve Black and Latino college and career readiness. And when she came, I sat down, I asked the woman, I said, is there a major urban district in the United States that stands out to you when it comes to working with Black and Latino young men in the high schools? And she said, the Boston Public School District. And I wonder what it is they do in the Boston Public Schools that make them, compared to other major urban districts, do well with young Black and Latino men. And I was thinking she was going to give me a very complex answer. Maybe it's their curriculum. Maybe it's their funding. Maybe it's the technology they use. And she gave me a very simple answer. She says, Boston Public Schools do very well with these young men, with these young Black and Latino men, because they go out of their way to hire Black and Latino male teachers. They said, it's not the money. It's not even the curriculum. It's not the technology. They said that these young boys, when they see someone that looks like them, they just respond better. They respond. And if we can keep our men in the church, it'll do a lot for our little boys coming up.
There's something about someone that comes from where they come from, that eats what they eat, that is into what they're into, that seen what they've seen and been through what they've been through. It's huge. And when she said that, I said, wow. And it said, you know what? I said, you know what? I can never forget that, because if the education, the field of education, they figured out that these young boys and people that look like them and understand them, then we need it even more here in the body of Christ. And so today we're going to look at a man in the Bible who, quote unquote, had it all, but it wasn't enough yet. And it wasn't until he had a conversation with Christ that he learned what it means to be a real man, to be a bearer of the flame. And that's what we're going to be looking at today. But before we go any further, let us bow our heads and close our eyes for a quick word of prayer. Father, we thank you for your grace and your mercy. We thank you for bringing us here safely, Lord. We pray again that you will take control of this service and of this message, that you will feed us your spiritual bread. Let Jesus Christ increase. Let me decrease. In the name of Jesus, we do pray. Amen. So we're going to open our Bibles to the book of John in the third chapter. And the way I traditionally preach is that I teach. So I work with the Youth Federation back in Northeastern Conference, and I work with young adults in Northeastern Conference. And being a teacher also, I learned that you got to sort of get to the point, I've learned. You know, sometimes we think that more is better. Sometimes less is more. Sometimes we think that fluffy words and all these things get the job done, but that's not always the case. We want to get to the point. And one thing I also want to do is when I preach, I like to preach, my notes are your notes. So it comes from the word so that when you go home, you can look over the text and look over the scriptures on your own, that you can study it on your own. Is that all right? You see, the problem is if your stomach is empty and I'm eating food, what does that do for your stomach? Absolutely nothing. Too often we expect the person preaching to get all the spiritual food. The same Bible that your favorite preacher or pastor reads is the same exact Bible that you have. Your favorite preacher, they brush their teeth like you in the morning. They tie their shoes like you in the morning. And they bleed red blood like you. If they can learn, you can learn too. There's nothing I have that you don't have. And so you guys will follow me in the text. And we will see what God has for us. Now we're going to open our Bibles to John 3 in the first chapter. John 3, chapter 3, verse 1. John 3, verse 1. So I'll give you guys a few moments to turn, and we have the text up here. Thank you. I'll read the text. I'm going to pause here and there, okay? It says, there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. Automatically, we have a guy that is what you call high class. To have been a Pharisee in this time and age, you needed to be married, preferably have children, be well educated. So you would have to have gone to Miami Union. Then you'd have maybe, you know, some of y'all might know about Pine Forge Academy. That costs a little more, so maybe you prefer the Pine Forge kid. Then the Oakwood kid, then the Andrews kid. You had to go the right routes. And Nicodemus went the right route. His resume was impressive. He had a nice cookie cutter Adventist resume. What you were looking for is what he had. He had money. He was well-connected, well-to-do, high position. They did not just choose anybody to be a Pharisee. You had to know your stuff. You had to have some theoretical knowledge. And Nicodemus was one of those guys, a respected man. Let's go down to verse 2 real quick. And we find something interesting, okay? I'm just going to go to the first comma only, and I've got to give you guys some context. It says in John 3, verse 2, the same, who's the same? That is Nicodemus, came to Jesus by night. And I can pause for a second. What in the world makes Nicodemus want to come to Jesus? Nicodemus, who's high class, who has a high position, not at the conference level, but at the union level. This guy who's well known, when he walks into a church and when he's the guest speaker, you guys bring out your best decorations. You bring out the best Sabbath lunch. You bring out the best musicians, the best everything when Nicodemus comes to visit Tabernacle. And now Nicodemus, high class, is talking to a low class brother. Now, you a and I are sitting here like, what do you mean Jesus is low class? What does that mean? You're not living in that time about 2,000 years ago. All right? We're in John 3. Before John 3 is what chapter? Before 3 is a number? If you read John 2, now we don't have time to read John 2, but you can read it on your own. If you read John the second chapter, it's something interesting in John 2. Jesus spends most of his life in the ghetto of Nazareth. And his first 29, 30 years of his life are sort of on the low. He lives in obscurity. Nobody really knows about Jesus. Jesus doesn't really blow up on the scene, you know, till he's about 30 years old. And now we see in John 2, Jesus goes to the temple. And now if Jesus goes to the temple, he's not well known. And when Jesus goes to the temple, he gets very upset. He takes a whip and he flips tables. And he does all these things to drive all the leaders out. Now, what was happening? At that time, they were celebrating a special feast called the Passover. The Passover comes from the Old Testament in Egypt. When the Israelites were being under Egyptian control, you know, Moses was sent to deliver them. And Pharaoh's like, I'm not letting them go. So there were 10 plagues. And the last plague was the death of the firstborn child. And you had to take the lamb of a blood, or the blood of a lamb, and you put it over your door, and the angel of death would do what when it came to your house? Pass over. Now, you had this Passover when it's a big deal. Now the Passover is a major deal, and so Jews from all over the world would come to Jerusalem to celebrate the Passover. It would be like you guys going to Camp Hawthorne, right? For camp meeting. You know, it's not just people from Miami. It's Miami, it's Orlando, it's Tampa, St. Petersburg, Naples, Tallahassee, Jacksonville, Daytona. Everybody comes together. Now at the Passover, you had to bring a lamb to be sacrificed because Passover was about a lamb's blood. Now the Pharisaical leaders were very corrupt. When people came from far, let's say you came from Jacksonville to Miami, you would have your lamb and your lamb would need to be sacrificed. The priest would see your lamb and he would say, well, your lamb doesn't pass our inspection. So now you want me to go all the way back to Jacksonville. Man, they had no cars, no buses, no trains, no planes. You want to go back to Jacksonville to get a new lamb? So the priest was so corrupt, even if your lamb was good, the priest would say, your lamb's not good. And you know what the priest would say? Well, since you can't go back to Jacksonville to buy a lamb, I got plenty of lambs back here that you could buy. True story. Read it. Read it. Desire of Ages elaborates on it. And so the priest would say, well, your lamb's not good, but you can buy. These leaders were corrupt. They said, you got to come buy my lamb. And so if you read the text, it says there were money changers also. Why? Because people had different types of currency. They came from far, and when they wanted to buy that lamb, they needed to change the currency. Jesus walks into the temple as a young 29, 30-year-old nobody. They don't know, who's that brother that's coming in there? Nobody knows him. Jesus walks, and he just checks the scene out. And his righteous anger is being kindled. He's saying, look how they're taking advantage of all the poor folk here. Look how they're taking advantage of all these people, and they're doing so much corrupt things. And Jesus gets so upset. He turns up, flips tables, takes his whip. I mean, he makes all the big shots. Conference president, union president, GC worker. They're all in the temple. He makes them all run up out of there. I can't make this up if I tried. And if you read John 2, they come back. When they run out the temple, they're like, wait a minute. Some dude who's a nobody, I don't know who he is, you don't know who he is, came up here and made us run all the way out of the temple, scared, like chickens with our head cut off. What's going on? And so now they say, let's go back and find out who this guy is. These guys want to know who Jesus is. A lot of the guys, they couldn't believe that could be God's son. And so Nicodemus, being nosy, wants to find out who Jesus is. That's why in John 3, Nicodemus, it says, he comes to him at what time of the day? Night. Why'd he go at night? He ain't want nobody to know. I'm telling you, did you know a lot of us, if we were living 2,000 years ago, we would not have accepted Jesus as God's son? First of all, he didn't have fancy clothes, number one. Read Isaiah 53. It said he was actually unattractive. Because if he was attractive, when he got up and preached at the altar call, all the women would have been like, he can pray over me first. God knows you're so shallow. Jesus had to be unattractive so you could fall in love with his character. And that's how shallow we are as humans. And Jesus, here's the worst part. People could not accept. Listen, where I live in Brooklyn, New York, not too far from me at my old school. It was a neighborhood called Crown Heights, Brooklyn. And in Crown Heights, Brooklyn, we have a very, very large Jewish community. And I mean, and they have these big signs that say, we're waiting for Messiah to come back. I had a friend of mine who lived in another part of Queens called Cambria Heights, Queens, where there's a big cemetery. And every year, there were a group of Jewish people that would go to her mother's house and offer to buy her mother's house cash, $600,000 cash, $700,000 cash. They don't do debit, credit, none. They do cash. And so the mother's like, no, I'm not selling my house. And I asked my friend, well, why do they want to buy your mother's house? And she said, because they believe the Messiah is buried in the cemetery near my mother's house. And they want to be around when he rises up from the grave. I said, I thought my people were late. They 2,000 years late. And do you want to know why they could not accept him? Because he was too poor. He was a carpenter's son. He was from Nazareth. Let me bring it home for you. If Jesus was a Miami boy, he would have been from Liberty City, Little Haiti, Opa-locka. Did I say it right? Opa-locka. If Jesus was a Florida boy, he would have been from Opa-locka. If he was from Jamaica, he would have been from Tivoli Gardens. If he was from Trinidad, he would have been from Laventil. If he was from Haiti, he would have been from Cité Soleil, La Saline. If he was from St. Lucia, Grenada, Guyana, Antigua, Barbados, Bahamas, Panama, Guyana, whatever you're from, think about the worst part of where you're from. That's where Jesus was from. John chapter 1. Can there any good thing come out of Liberty City? Tivoli Gardens? Nazareth? They said, how could God, who sits up high and looks down low, have one son and his son be from the ghetto? And his son be poor, and he doesn't have fancy clothes, and he doesn't even have a good job. He's a regular blue-collar 9-to-5 guy. How can that guy be God's son? A lot of people are shallow, and they missed out on his first advent. Nicodemus thinks he's got it all together, but he's still a little bit interested in this guy. Nicodemus says, I can't let the other guys know about him. The other Pharisees hate him, and they want to kill him. But I am interested in learning about this guy's teaching. But you got to remember that Nicodemus is 2,000 years ago. So Nicodemus now, he has to go find out. Let me tell you about these young people nowadays. Young people have taken this thing called social media, and they get all the 411, all the scoop, all the information they need on someone they could do on social media. They can go to a big event, and they can go, I went to Federation the other day, man. There was a young lady I seen. She was hanging out with the girl from Tabernacle. That girl's on my Facebook. I'm going to go on her Facebook. I'm going to look at her pictures. I'm going to see if she got homegirl tagged in her pictures. I'm going to go find out exactly who she is. People will find out who you are. People use Google, they use whatever to find out who you are. People will find out whatever it takes to get information on you. Now, back in his day, Nicodemus didn't have a social media. Nicodemus didn't have a Google. So Nicodemus's nosy behind wants to find out who was that boss that walked in to the temple. He's not related to nobody important. He doesn't go to any big church. He comes from nowhere, and he came in there with power. Who was that man? A real man? So that's why Nicodemus asked one person who knows another person who knows another person, where does this guy tend to lay low? And Nicodemus finds out that Jesus likes to pray in the night at the Mount of Olives. And so Nicodemus waits for the whole Miami to be sleeping. I don't know, does that happen? I don't know if that actually happens. But he waits for the whole town to quiet down. No electricity, lights are out, everybody's sleeping. Nicodemus says, all right, it's time for me to go and find out who this brother is. And Nicodemus goes up, and he's looking in the mountain for Jesus, and it's pitch black, dark outside, and he finds Jesus. And if we can go back to the text, verse 2 again, John 3, verse 2, it says, the same came to Jesus by night and said unto him, Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher come from God, for no man can do these miracles that thou do except God be with him. Nicodemus is doing what a lot of people in church like to do. He's trying to butter Jesus up to get information from Jesus. You see, Nicodemus thinks he's giving Jesus a shout out. He's saying, Rabbi. He thinks, what's up, boss? What's up, chief? What's up, captain? You know, when you tell guys, oh, you the man. And like, yeah, I know I am. Yes, I know I am. Nicodemus is trying to give Jesus some props. God's son is not impressed by you calling him Rabbi. And Nicodemus is Rabbi. And then he wants to do his politics with Jesus. You know how people in the church are. They want to get information from you. Sister So-and-so, I loved your outfit. You guys did an amazing job on Sabbath. Oh, that was great, Sister So-and-so. Yes, yes. Oh, you guys did a great. The men's choir was amazing. The men's choir. I loved the whole bow tie thing. And I liked the whole suits and everything. Girl, did you hear what happened after Sabbath lunch? When people want to get information from you, they will butter you up and tell you everything you want to hear. Nicodemus said, let me butter Jesus up real quick to get the information that I need from Jesus. And he's trying to big up Jesus and trying to get in Jesus' head and gas him up, but it doesn't work. Go down to verse 3. Verse 3 says this. Jesus doesn't play games. Jesus doesn't do politics. John 3, verse 3, it says this. Jesus answered and said unto him, verily, verily. For those that don't know street slang, I know this is on the King James. If this was today, my students in New York would be like, real talk, for real, for real. For real, for real. Verily, verily, I say unto ye, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Jesus is not into your nice church politics. He's like, man, you trying to big me up? You calling me rabbi? You telling me I do all these nice things? I want you to be converted. I'm not interested in your position, your title, or your theory. You need to be converted. And that's what Jesus tells him direct. And if not, you cannot see the kingdom of God. Let's go down to John 3, verse 4. Nicodemus said unto him, now Nicodemus, I don't know if he's being sarcastic or fresh or what it is. Nicodemus said unto him, how can a man be born when he's old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? Nicodemus, almost like he's being fresh. Well, I'm a grown man. Would you want me to go back in my mother's stomach again? What do you mean I got to be born again? Right? Can I go back? And verse 5 says this, Jesus answered, verily, verily, I say it again. I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot see enter into the kingdom of God. I'll pause here quickly, and then we'll go to our next section. We're going to go through just three quick sections, and that's it. So I'm going to the point. Nicodemus, Jesus says to Nicodemus, you got to be born of the water first, and then you got to be born of the what? Born of the water, Jesus is saying you got to be baptized. Now, what does Jesus mean by that? By that, he means I want you to make a public declaration to the world that I'm number one now. You know, I remember growing up in my church, baptism was like a scare tactic. It was a big time scare tactic. Oh, you got to be a certain age. In my church growing up, everybody knew that by the time you were 13 and it was a summer crusade, just get in line to get baptized. We didn't know what we was getting baptized for, but we knew, I'm 13. Oh yeah, last year my cousin got baptized. Well, next year I'm going to be 13. Or I'm going to get baptized at the summer. You know, there was a summer revival and it was always some 13, 14 year old getting baptized. Pressure from the parents. Hey, you know, you got to get baptized this year. You saw someone so got baptized last year. They got baptized and he's only 1 year older than you. You got to get baptized too. Y'all know exactly what I'm talking about. They don't know what they signing up for. All baptism is, it's equivalent to a wedding, but to Christ. You see, when I got married and I went down the aisle with my wife, I let the whole world know I've got a new number one. What a wedding is with your spouse is what baptism is to Jesus. It's literally just a wedding to Jesus, letting people know Jesus is number one. That's the bar's not number one, the club's not number one, line's not number one, the wife is not number one anymore. Jesus is number one. So baptism is a public declaration of your love for Jesus. That's all it is. Now let me ask you a question. Has a wedding ever made a successful marriage? There's not a wedding on earth that made a successful marriage. Some people have spent millions of dollars on weddings and had horrible marriages. Baptism is your public declaration, but you got to put in the work. Just like in marriage, no one's going to do the work for you. You got to put in the work. And so Jesus said, I want you to get baptized. Not that baptism brings you to heaven. No, no, no. Baptism is letting the world know that I'm number one. But you got to have the relationship. That's why he says born of the water and born of the Spirit. He compares it to the wind. Does anybody know what the wind looks like? The height, its weight, its color? No. But you see the effects of the wind. If the wind came in here and knocked everything off here, and you see the wind was there like the Holy Spirit, you may not see the Holy Spirit, but if you come in contact, it should have an effect on you. That will clear up towards the end. I'll clear that up towards the end. But I just want to emphasize this in the first part of the text. Nicodemus goes to see Jesus in John 3 at what time of the day? Because he's afraid of what? People think. One more time. In John 3, Nicodemus sees Jesus. Now, Nicodemus is a quote-unquote the man. But is he a real man yet? He says, I'm going to see Jesus and at nighttime because I don't want nobody to know I'm afraid of what people think. There's two more times we see Nicodemus. I'm going to hit those quickly, and then we'll bring it home. Go a few chapters over to John chapter 7 now. Let's go to John chapter 7. I'm going to go to verse 32. So we see Nicodemus, high-ranking Pharisee, talking to a low carpenter from Liberty City, Opa-locka. And so now, he doesn't want to be caught. He doesn't want nobody to know that he's interested in the teachings of Jesus. He's worried about what people think. John 7, we see Nicodemus in verse 32. The Pharisees heard that the people murmured or complained such things concerning him or talked about him. And the Pharisees, now it's talking about Jesus. And the Pharisees and the chief priests sent officers to take him. To take who again? So Jesus, this is something interesting. All Jesus does is preach, teach, heal, and bless people. And now people want to lock him up. And if you read it earlier, they actually wanted to kill him. I don't have time to go in, but if you read John 7 on your own, they actually wanted to kill him first. But they said, oh, you know what? There's a lot of people here. It's really, you know, too much going on. Let's lock him up. You know what I've learned? And I always talk to my students about this. My students will sit in class, and they let somebody get in their head. There are a lot of people that literally give people the keys to their head. They say, well, here's the keys to my head. Set me off. Make me mad. Let me explain something, and I'll connect this real quick. A quick commercial I'm going to make in this. Jesus did absolutely nothing wrong and walked perfect his whole life, and there still managed to be people who hated him. And you're shocked that people hate you. I'm always shocked when people say, I don't know why they don't like me. It doesn't matter. If Jesus, who was perfect and never messed up once, there were people who hated him, what are you making a big deal? People hate you. I tell my students, let people get in their head. I say, hold on, so-and-so. Did so-and-so buy your sneakers? Nah, they ain't buy my sneakers. Did they buy your outfit? No. Did they feed you yesterday? Nah. Did they pay your rent? Nah. So why do you care? We give people too much power and too much attention. And they don't feed you. They don't pay your bills. They don't clothe you. They don't pay your mortgage. They don't pay your property tax. They don't pay none of your car note. Who cares? You know, you pray for them. That's all you can do. You pray for that person. But if you are shocked that someone doesn't like you, read your Bible, take a look at the perfect Jesus, and know that you're not the first person to be disliked. They dislike him so much, they want to kill him, but they can't. They see a sort of it's a spicy moment to do it, so let's not do it. But let's arrest him. If we can lock Jesus up, we can shut down his ministry. So they sent officers now to arrest Jesus. Let's see what happens when they send the officers to arrest Jesus. Go stay in John 7 and go to verse 45. They are sending these people to arrest him. John 7 verse 45. Then came the officers to the chief priests and Pharisees. And they said unto them, why have you not brought him? What just happened over here? They did not arrest who? Jesus. They were supposed to arrest Jesus. And now they come back empty-handed. So the Pharisees are upset. Why is he not here? You can go down to verse 46. They said, the officers answered, never man spoke like this man. Listen, and you know why? Because never man lived like that too. You see, they were used to the fake Christianity, the fake surface level stuff. And now they found a man who believes what he says and he teaches and preaches with power. They said, we've never seen anybody talk like this. We went to lock him up, and we wanted to stay and listen to him talk. We really wanted to stay and listen to him. Now, check for verse 47. I told you, my notes are your notes here. Then answered them the Pharisees, are you also deceived? Y'all see the text? You can think for yourself, you see. Like, what, you also falling for his nonsense? Next verse. Have any of the rulers or the Pharisees believed in him? Do you see any of us leaders believe in this guy? So why do you believe in that crazy man? That man from the ghetto? That poor man from Nazareth? Now it gets even more interesting. Let's go down. But this people who know it's not the law cursed. Again, you can go down again. Nicodemus. So we first see Nicodemus in John chapter 3. The next time we see Nicodemus in John chapter, look at Nicodemus. Nicodemus said unto them, he that came to Jesus by, why did he come by night? Because he was embarrassed and ashamed, right? Being one of them, does our law judge any man before it hears him and knows what he does? Guess who made some growth? In John chapter 3, he doesn't want anybody to know. In John 7, he comes and he says, listen, we can't judge this guy before we hear him. Let me tell you something about the Christian walk. Everyone, I'm talking to men and women, even though it's a men's ministry. Christianity follows the laws of plant life. Now, I can give a better example living in New York. You know, I mean, we have our four seasons. Even though you got here, it's like it's hot or it's not hot or it's rain or it's not raining, right? In New York, we have, you know, we have your four seasons. We have winter, spring, summer, and fall, right? Two of the seasons, plants do one of two things. Plants are either growing. And if a plant is not growing, guess what it's doing? Plants never just stay static. There's not a plant on earth that just stays static. That's why people have to trim plants, because they keep growing. Plants either grow or die. In New York, in the fall and winter, what are the plants doing? In the spring and summer, what are they doing? Are they ever just there? Never. Your Christian walk, every single person sitting here in Tabernacle, from myself to you guys, as of now, you are doing one of two things. You are either growing or dying. There is no middle ground. There's no just being static. You're either growing or you're dying. You're growing or you're dying. You better be honest with yourself. Don't lie to yourself. Am I growing? Because if I'm not chilling. I'm dying. Is Nicodemus growing or dying? You see what happens when you have some interaction with Jesus? John 3, he's like, man, I can't let nobody know what's going on. Shh, don't tell nobody. Four chapters later in John 7, fellas, come on. Is it fair for us to judge the guy without hearing him out? That is growth. That is growth. Nicodemus has shown that he's growing. Verse 52. Look what they said to him. They're disrespectful. They answered and said unto him, are you also from Galilee? Liberty City, Tivoli Gardens, Cité Soleil. Search and look, for out of Galilee arise no prophet. Maybe they weren't searching and looking. Do you see how Nicodemus, they already canceled it. Man, he's from the ghetto. He can't be nobody important. He can't be God's son. And so now you see the situation. But Nicodemus is unmoved at this point. Nicodemus has shown that he's growing. You got to ask yourself, what's getting in the way of me growing? Man, there's a lot of things that get in the way of us growing. First of all, we're afraid to turn over all the stones of our lives. There's stuff that hurt. It's like ripping off an old Band-Aid, and you don't want to open that scar. But you got to trust that God wants to address that and deal with it and fix it. Then another thing that hurts our men is we have a lot of spectator men. We got to get this out. I was talking to somebody, and they were saying that God was saying, we give, you know, the way worship is in Christianity, Christianity is not a spectator type of a religion. It is an experience religion. A lot of times, we have a lot of people that's in church, and we give a lot of directions in church, and that's, I get it, right? Stand up, sit down, sing, give money. Stand up, sit down, sing, give money. Stand up, sit down, sing, give money. Brothers taking orders all day. I mean, I can't keep taking orders like this all day, man. But you got to go and then do something. They said that a person has a 95% chance of remembering what you teach them if they go and teach it to somebody else. You know, let me tell you, you see a lot of preachers. Preachers are not the best people walking around. Preachers are so messed up, a lot of us, that God has to give us this to make us read our Bible. He gives us something to do to make us get on our knees. God will give you something to do, and he wants you to be active. He doesn't want you to listen. You're not meant to sit still. If you don't use them, you lose them. Brothers, you may not have a position in church, but in your neighborhood, in your family, or you taking, if you think, you know what, I'm going to pray in my family. We can pray for 10 minutes tonight at 9 o'clock. But you know what? That means I got to have at least one verse to share with them. That forces you to get into your word now. And now that you reteach it, you hold it and retain it more. We've got to be active and watching. Another thing is we got to find time to be in our word. We got to stop comparing ourselves. Oh, they just bought a house out there and blah, 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 but we got to buy a house now. And now, you instead of focusing on what you got to focus on, you worry about comparing yourself to people. We're materialistic. We have avoidance behaviors. There's a lot of things that keep us from going. And we need to start asking ourselves, what is it? And you got to be honest. Sit there and say, what is it that stops me from growing? God, show me. Because I see Nicodemus growing. I want to grow also and become a better man, a better bearer of the flame. We have one last text. Go to John chapter 19. One last text we're going to look at. You're going to John chapter 19 and verse 38. We're going to get ready to bring this to its final portion. I told you, teachers, we get to the point. This is the third time, final time we see Nicodemus. We see Nicodemus in John 3. When does he go to see Jesus? At what? Nighttime. John 7, he now defends who? Jesus. John chapter 19. After this, Joseph of Arimathea, who was another disciple, not Joseph, Jesus' father, he had passed by them, being a disciple of the Jews, but what? Secretly. But secretly for fear of the Jews. He besought or asked Pilate that he might take away the body of Jesus off the cross. So Jesus has just died. He's on the cross. He's dying. He's hanging. And now someone needs to take his body. So Joseph of Arimathea asked to take Jesus' body off the cross. And Pilate gave him leave or permission. He came therefore and took the body of Jesus. Next verse. And there came also who? The third time we see Nicodemus. Watch what he's doing this time. Which at first came to Jesus by what? Night. And brought a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 100 pounds in weight. Next verse, which is our last verse. Then they, Joseph and who? Joseph and who? Nicodemus took Jesus' body off. Took Jesus' body off the cross, and they wound it in linen, clothes, and with spices, as the manner of the Jews is to bury. People forget that Nicodemus went to get him ready to be buried. Do you see the growth that Nicodemus makes? Nicodemus becomes a real man now. See, in John 3, he had a fancy resume. You know, maybe he went to the University of Miami. Maybe he went here, there. He was a well-respected professor in the South Florida community. Everybody knew him when he walks into the church. Everybody salutes him. He thought he was the man. And God said, listen, man, let me teach you what a real man is. They mean not the Mount of Olives. He has some interaction with Jesus. Four chapters later, in John 7, he now defends Jesus. And in John 19, he helps take Jesus' body off the cross. This is called growth. This is called growth. This is called turning into a real man, turning into a real Christian. A real man becomes a man after he comes in contact with Jesus. You see, as a young man read so eloquently, our scripture came from Luke 2, verse 52. And it said, and Jesus grew in wisdom, stature, and favor with God and men. Jesus, who was God, turns into a human to save humans. That's even worse than me becoming an ant to save ants. Jesus comes down, becomes a human, and Jesus has to learn everything from scratch. And Jesus has to grow and turn into a real man. When it says Jesus grew in wisdom, it's so that Jesus grew mentally. Jesus growing in stature, he grew physically. Jesus growing in favor with God is spiritually, and Jesus growing in favor with man is socially. Jesus grew mentally, he grew physically, he grew spiritually, he grew socially. Men, are we growing in those four ways? Are we taking care of our bodies? Are we challenging ourselves mentally? Is our social interaction with people positive? And are we growing spiritually? What I love about Jesus so much is you don't have to have money to grow in Christ. You don't need to have any possessions to grow in Christ. You don't even come from a strong family. You can come from the dysfunction of all dysfunction and still grow in Christ. All you need to do is spend some time in your word. And you see, he says, listen, it's like when you eat, when you spend some time reading your word, it's like getting your spiritual food. And when you spend some time on your knees, it's about getting the breath of God. Like God, it's like, it says, Thessalonians 5 verse 17, pray without ceasing, like you breathe without ceasing. Don't we breathe without ceasing? And then what I love about God, if you spend time with Jesus, after Nicodemus spends a short moment with Jesus, it has an impact. He turns it to a real man. And here's a great part about it. You don't even need to do that. Listen, you don't have to do anything crazy. God will have you grow by himself. Let me tell you something. There were young boys that start in church and they'll be this size. and they become 5 years old, and they become 10 years old, and they become 15 and 20 and 25 and 30. Well, I was young at one point, but I'm getting older. When I started to grow facial hair, do you think that I forced it? It was something that happened naturally. Just by eating my human nutrients made me grow physically. So by getting my spiritual nutrients naturally, you don't even have to force it. You know, a lot of people, they start, I want to get in my word, and I want to change overnight. I want to be super Christian tomorrow. God's saying, just spend some time with me, and naturally, I'll make you grow. Did you know that when plants grow, they grow in silence? You know, plants don't make noise when they grow, and they grow imperceptibly. You can't even perceive when they're growing, but you see the growth. I know you're struggling, men. I know it hurts. I know it feels like you're not supposed to be where you're supposed to be. But if Nicodemus could start from scratch and grow and become a real man, why can't you grow? Nicodemus was human like you. Again, he bleed red blood like you, and he woke up in the morning tied his shoes like you too. If Nicodemus could grow and become a man, even after being a grown man, learning how to be a real man, we can also. I'm going to close with these two examples, and then I will take my seat. You see, if I came here and I told you that I was late, let's say I came late, I came at 12 o'clock, and you say, Pastor Coicou, why were you late? Why weren't you able to make it on time? And I said, well, we were driving down I-95, and there was a big 18-wheeler truck that came. And the 18-wheeler truck comes, and it comes down 95, and it was going 70 miles an hour, and it smacked me. But I just got up, even though it hit me 70 miles an hour, and I'm here in perfect. I have nothing on me. Yeah, but like, that brother is lying through his teeth. Ain't no way an 18-wheeler truck was going 75 miles an hour, or 995, hit you, and unless it was a miracle of God. You would expect that if a car or truck had hit me, that it would leave some type of impact on me, that it would leave a mark on me. And we see that in John 3 when Jesus gets hit. Nicodemus gets what? Hit by Jesus. He has an interaction and it impacts him. It leaves a mark. Ladies and gentlemen, how long have we been in church our whole lives? And we claim, I got Jesus. Jesus' impact on you will be harder than an 18-wheeler truck. If a truck would hit you and change you, what happens when Jesus would hit you? It's got to change us. I don't care how messed up you feel mentally. I don't care how low you feel. Jesus will leave an impact that's harder than a truck. The last example is this. You know, although I live in New York, I spent time in other places. I spent some time in Boston, and I spent some time in Philadelphia. And what I learned is no matter where you go, people have their own lingo and their own slang. People have certain accents and they talk a certain way. When I went to Boston, my students would say certain things when I'd give them a lot of homework. So they thought I gave them too much homework, they're always saying, oh, Mr. Coicou, you forcing it. You forced it. That's what they like to say. You forced it. My students in New York, if I give them too much homework, they were saying, oh, you OD'ing right now. And you can tell who's who by the way they talk. In Boston, they had a funny way they talk. They don't have a 26-letter alphabet in Boston. They got a 25-letter alphabet. They don't pronounce their R's in Boston. They say, I went to go park my car in Harvard Yard. And they don't say park, I park. And you could tell, I mean, well, that's a Boston guy. But the craziest experience is when I went to Philadelphia. I went to Philadelphia for college, and Philadelphia is only 2 hours from New York. And I go to Philadelphia, and when I get to campus, the Philly guys have a whole nother lingo that's a foreign language to me. So you were on campus and the guys, they would see an attractive lady walk by and they would be like, oh, that's a bad joint, bro. That's a bad joint, bro. I said, okay. In Philadelphia slang, when they say joint, they're talking about a woman. But then a nice car would drive by with nice rims. They'd be like, oh, you see that joint over there, bro? That joint is nice. I said, got it. So a joint in Philadelphia could be a woman or a nice car. And somebody walked by with some nice sneakers. They're like, check that joint out. I said, okay, cool. Woman, car, sneakers. And they're eating food. Oh, this joint tastes good. Okay, woman, car, sneakers, food. And I said, guys, joint means, can y'all break down joint for me, please? They're like, listen, a joint is a noun, a person, place, or a thing. That's what they're in Philadelphia. A joint, that's what it is. And I said, what? And they use the word so much, this is how they give directions. They be like, oh, where you trying to go? You trying to go to Tabernacle, bro? Listen, you trying to go to that joint? Listen, man, Go straight down that joint all the way. Make a right at that joint. Make a left at the next joint. When you see that light, make another right at that joint. Go over the joint, under the joint. Go see a big joint on your side, don't stop there. Keep going around that joint. Then when you see that other joint, go past that joint. And then you finally gonna see the joint right there. I said, what kind of language is this? By the time I left Philadelphia, guess what word I was saying? That joint crazy, man. I can't believe that joint, man. I can't believe that joint. And what I realized was that the more time I spent in the presence of Philadelphians, the more I started to think and act and talk like them. I started to become a real Philadelphian. I didn't force it. Just by being in their presence, I thought like them and talked like them and walked like them and started to act like them without even trying to be that way. If I could be that way by being in the presence of Philadelphians, how much of a real man will I become if I'm in the presence of Jesus Christ? That joint won't be for real. Serious business. Men, I know we have nothing, but God will take you and recycle you. You know, I'm reading a devotional and it says, the only thing extraordinary, the only talent that the disciples had was that they were ordinary. Jesus took regular nobodies with no name, with no position, with no talent. The only thing they were extraordinary at was being ordinary. And Jesus is the ultimate garbage recycler. He takes trash and he recycles it into beautiful things. And like he recycled Nicodemus, he wants to recycle you. He wants to recycle me. The worse you are, the more he wants to recycle you. The more messed up you feel, the more he wants to recycle you. The more low you feel, the more he wants to recycle you. And he'll turn you into a beautiful joint. God bless you. We're going to ask the men to come up for a special prayer, for a special closing prayer, not a special prayer intercession, I apologize. I'm going to ask Pastor Ted if you come up and lead us out. I'm going to ask all the men to come up here for a special prayer so that God could turn you into a real man like he turned Nicodemus into a real man. We ask all the brothers to come on up. God didn't tell Nicodemus to go back in his mother's stomach again. He said, you're already a grown man, but it's never too late to start. Even as a grown man, you can start again. God takes Nicodemus as a grown man and he turns him into something beautiful. In John 3, we see him grow to John 7. And we see who Nicodemus becomes in John 19. There's no reason why us as men cannot grow the same way he did. Just make yourself available. You messed up? That's okay. You feel you don't have no talent? That's okay. People don't like you? That's even more okay. The worse you are, the better position you are. Let the garbage recycler recycle you. Let the garbage collector recycle you like he collected Nicodemus and he recycled him and you saw the product in John 19. I'm messed up. Messed up. But I'm not worried. Because the more messed up I am, the more the garbage collector is going to do more with me. And take a regular, ordinary man and make him extraordinary in Christ to be a bearer of the flame. We're going to have a special prayer. We're going to ask Pastor Taylor to lead us on this special prayer.
Let's bow our heads and let us pray. Lord, we feel as men today here, we feel like those disciples on the walk to Emmaus. And in our hearts, we're saying, did not our hearts burn as we listen to you speak through your manservant today to remind us that you are the best recycler that a man could ever have. Lord, we come to this altar today with our weaknesses, our fears, our backgrounds, our challenges, our addictions, our social and mental and physical challenges. We come today knowing that our God is a mighty God. And we believe as men that when we place our hands in the hands of the man Jesus who stilled the water, He can change our lives. So we surrender our lives to you today, Lord. Again, we give our minds, our hearts, our goals, our purposes, our objectives, our attitudes, all that we are. Today, again, we give it to you. Because, Lord, we want to be the man that you want us to be. We want to shine for Jesus in our homes. We want to shine for Jesus in our community. We want to shine for Jesus even in our private life when no one is watching. We still want to shine for you. So we ask you to forgive us for where we've fallen short. Forgive us for where we ignored the Spirit. Forgive us for where you have tried to guide us and teach us and move us in a direction that we rebelled and went in the opposite direction. Lord, please have mercy on us. Forgive us, for many of us are suffering because we ignored you. But thank God, Jesus is a Redeemer. And we have, even today, experienced your redemptive power. Thank you, Lord. We thank you so much. We pray that you'll help us so that we'll be an example to our sons and our daughters, examples to our young men in the community and in this church, that they could look to us as men and say, there's a man of God that walks and talks and lives as if he's spending time with Jesus and is growing like Nicodemus grew. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings. And then, Lord, we want to also appeal to that young man, that young woman, that man, that woman today who've come out today, even those who are listening online, and they've heard the voice of God speak to them, and Lord, they want to make a decision for you today. And I appeal to you in this prayer, if God has touched you, if you have not surrendered your heart to him, if you have not given your life to him, knowing what he's done for you, give your life to Jesus today. Give your heart to Jesus today. And you'll never, like Nicodemus, be the same again. In Jesus' name I pray, let all of God's children say, amen, amen, amen.
Man, remain in place, please. Remain in place. Man, remain in place, please. We'd like to thank Pastor Coicou for such a powerful message about the growth of men and what we need to do to increase our spiritual health. There were four components to it, and we're going to repeat a pledge actually that have some of the same components. Can we put the pledge up on the wall on the screen? And what the pledges talk about, our relationship to God first. Then it talks about our relationship to the family and the relationship to the church. And lastly, relationship to each other as men. And so as we repeat this pledge coming up, I will say the bold type and you respond by reading the lighter print, okay? It starts out, a mighty man puts Christ first in his life. A mighty man abides in Christ. A mighty man is the servant leader of his family. A mighty man is personally invested in serving Christ's church. A mighty man is a leader of men. Lastly, a mighty man has a personal ministry of discipleship with men. Thank you, man. Thank you. You may return to your seats as we turn our hymnals, or they put it on the screen, to hymn number 304, Faith of Our Fathers. And we're going to sing it like Tabernacle can sing it. And I'd like the ladies to stand, the congregation, please stand as we sing hymn number 304, Faith of Our Fathers.
For the benediction. Oh, how good and pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. Father, our hearts are filled with joy because from last night until now, Lord, we felt the Holy Spirit moving up and down in this building. We thank you, Lord, for the sacrifice that you have made on the cruel cross of Calvary, so that we can have opportunity today to experience what that sacrifice means to us. Father, we thank you for all the men that participate in this weekend's program, Lord. Father, you have challenged us and you have asked us to be real men. You have cautioned us, Lord, that we should be men in our homes, in our workplace, wherever we go, whenever we get ourselves involved with any situation, Lord, we need to stand up for you, though the heavens fall. I pray today, Lord, that we will take this in our hearts and that our lives may be transformed and we'll learn to be more like you. We thank you for blessing us. We thank you for the speaker who have delivered an awesome message today. Lord, we ask that you may help this message to linger with us, Lord. Wherever we go, remind us, Lord, that we need to take off the masks that we have. Because there are so many, hatred, gossip, and many other different ones that we don't even remember what they are. We ask that you must help us to do that. And when you come, Lord, may we all be ready to go home with you, where there will be no more sickness, no more pain, for the former things have passed away, and you have come to make all things new. Lord, I pray that every one of us in this building, under the sound of my voice, will be there on that great day when you will be our speaker, when you will be our the one that will usher us into the kingdom. We thank you and we bless your name. In the holy name of your son, Jesus Christ, we pray. Let everyone say amen. Go into all the world and exalting them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I command. I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. You can be seated, you'll be ushered out.
Just a brief announcement, please, while you sit. We're asking all the men that participated in today's program, we're asking you to please remain seated. The rest of us, church members, guests, visitors, we're asking you to please convene in the foyer, and also you may join us for lunch, second floor. All right? Thank you. God bless you. Ladies, we have an appointment tomorrow, 10 o'clock, for prayer breakfast. Thank you. God bless you. Do enjoy the rest of the day.